Well, it's not like I'm going to be
absolutely the hardest thing to
do. In a way, for a Disney movie, it's kind of surprising.
The movie made them very nervous, obviously.
I wonder sometimes if there's a virtue also in being outside Los Angeles, and I'm thinking about Laika Graham. Do you think that the fact that you guys are kind of far away ever helps in your creative process?
Definitely. I think everyone sees it in the movies we make. There's a lot of Portland that kind of creeps into those movies. Mm-hmm. It's just part of the culture and sort of the eclectic mix of people up there. And it's funny thinking of like studio intervention. I mean, we're in a weird, unique spot in that we really kind of have Travis Knight to deal with, but we don't really have much beyond that. So we kind of work fairly closely with Travis. And for the most part, I mean, I've worked as a story artist on Coraline, Paranorman, and now the Box Trolls, and we're kind of mostly left our own devices. But every now and again, Travis will step in and say, you know, you need this or that. And I specifically remember on the Box Trolls, we had in one of the early iterations, we had this great fish out of water sequence with Eggs, our main character, and he was at a tea party with Winnie's parents, and it really worked great. And it was one of the few things in those early screenings that for the studio was working great. Everybody agreed it was a really good scene. But as the movie began to evolve, Travis came in at a certain point and said, you guys, much as we all love it, we need to rework, make that moment bigger. It has to be a bigger moment. It just needs to, for the whole film, needs to balance it a little better. So we went back to the drawing board and came up with, Tony and I thought, really clever idea of doing a whole big ballroom dancing scene, which ultimately became the absolute hardest thing we had to do in the movie. But we didn't know that. Neither Tony and I were really sort of stop motion guys at heart, so we didn't quite recognize the logistical pain it was going to cause in all the departments. But it was what Travis had sort of pushed us into doing, so it was one of those moments where it was kind of nice that he had sort of seen it from a big picture perspective, because we were so in the trenches of the story, and that moment became something really special because of that.
Did you ever have a moment where your crew said, look, guys, cool idea, we can't do that?
To their credit, they've never sort of said that to our faces.
Yeah.
But there's been a lot of those moments. you hear a little bit
conversations
of
conversations
around the water cooler.
Nobody wants to be that person, I think.
That dance sequence was one of those moments where, you know, as I'm sure you guys do in your process, we have those sequence breakdown meetings, and that's when all the heads of the departments get together in a room and we go shot by shot and everybody divvies up the workload, who's going to do what. And those meetings are always can be contentious or whatever, but there's always a lot of energy. Everybody's amped up to kind of, they've all done their homework coming into the room. They know how they're going to attack certain problems and how they're going to. We have a real bizarre setup too, where because we're this stop motion studio, we've got this mix of futurists and Luddites all together sharing the same parking lot. And it is always a bit of a, you know, it's friendly, but it is a bit of a competitive thing as whether it's going to be practical or whether it's going to be digital. It all has to fit. Whatever's going to fit the style of the film usually wins. Anyway, there's always a little bit of battling. Usually, yeah, the room's kind of buzzing when you walk in, but when we walked in for the breakdown for the dance sequence, dead silent. Nobody was talking. No one would even make eye contact with Tony and I when we came in. So that was the first and only real moment in it where, as directors, we thought, oh, maybe we may have overstepped our boundaries here. Maybe we can't pull this off.
Right.
But again, everybody just hunkered down. We began to go just step through it methodically, and we got to an end result. I mean, it took all 18 months of the shooting schedule to get like a little less than 2 minutes of footage done. But I think, you know, it was all worth it when you look at it now.
I think that's a common thing in animation is like anytime, nobody wants to be that person to say no. Mm-hmm. You know, that everybody loves the challenge. And I know it's that case at our studio as well, that you know, they'll tell us if it's going to be difficult. But they'll generally never say we can't do it. It's a lot of times it's like, okay, give us a minute to figure it out, but we'll get it done, you know. And I think that's kind of like everybody in animation. They just want to do the best job they can and put the best story up on film.
They'll ask you if it's important to you because
exactly.
Like, is it really important that it's important at night because the light is going to be much harder to execute? Right. And you say, yeah, it's really important. And they say, okay, fine.
And then we won't see our families for 4 months. But okay.
Hero can ruffle his hair.
We'll give you that hair.
Yeah. Jorge, did you have that experience? I mean, you were asking the animators to do these very intricate, really different characters. Did they ever?
Yeah. I mean, one of the things that I, as a lover of animation, I would see the characters get really watered down by the time they got to the movie. And the more I researched it, the more I realized every department has a head, that goes, well, that's too hard to model. Let's model it so it's easier to light. And so, but every department has their say. And by
the
end,
do you mean like visually watered down, like from your original sketches?
From what when I would see stuff, and I would see, wow, now this is a character that's perfect to animate, perfect to light, perfect to texture, perfect to model, but it's super weak sauce design wise because it's every department has had their say. So as a character designer of the movie and as a director, I got to say, like a tank, like, no, like all the bullets would come. Like, that's going to be impossible to light. That's going to be impossible to model. And I challenged, and I kind of challenged every team. I said, let's pretend we're stop motion and someone just handed you the puppet and you're the animator. How the hell are you going to move it? See you tomorrow. Like, this is your challenge to you guys. And if people can do it in the real world, then we can certainly do it in the computer. And same thing with the designs. In the beginning, we had all these designs, and a lot of the CG guys would go, this is impossible. You can't have this much detail. You can't make these characters. So our production designer went to El Salvador. He took all the drawings, no turnarounds, nothing, just drawings, got a bunch of artisans. They built all the maquettes, brought them back to Texas, and we said, if people can build this in the real world, you can build it in the computer. And so that became the look of the movie.